Hey everyone, my name is Oleg. A fun fact about me, my dad's name is also Oleg. Let's call him Oleg 1 and I'll be Oleg 2. Why is this important? Well, in 2014, Oleg 1 invested in a company called DrChrono. That got my foot in the door, and in 2018, I started working at DrChrono. That same year, I approached my boss Daniel with an idea for a podcast, and he told me to run with it. Fast forward to today, I'm still recording interviews, but as the show has evolved, I've decided to do a little bit of rebranding. So, I'm pleased to announce that for the first time, you're listening to On the Health Record. I wanted a name that was a little bit more descriptive and fun, and I think On the Health Record accomplishes that. This show is going to be about electronic health records and everything around them in healthcare technology. So, if you're new to the show, welcome, and if you're returning, welcome back. We also have a new logo. Big thanks to Semi Park, who does design at our company. She came up with a lot of great designs, and this one was my favorite, so I hope you enjoy it as much as I do. What's going to be different about this is we're trying out a series of episodes. You know, before the interviews were kind of one-off interviews, I really enjoyed doing them, and I think they're valuable, but there was no real through line to this whole thing. So, this time around, we're trying to package together 6 episodes, all with the overarching theme of living in a world with COVID-19. The first 2 episodes are going to be DrChrono focused, and they should set us up to talk about, you know, all the stuff we want to talk about in the future. This episode is going to be about DrChrono the product. I'll explain a little bit more soon. And episode 2, we're talking about the people at DrChrono. So what's our culture and values like, and how do we hire here? Next, I look at the market for EHRs with Class Research Group. They put together a best-in-class report for healthcare technology every year. After that, we'll do 3 partner interviews for the second half of the show. These are all going to be with founders who are at the helms of really exciting companies for this moment. The first one of those is going to be about virtual rooms and telehealth, which is kind of the hot topic. Not even kind of. It is the hot topic in healthcare today. Then we'll talk data and analytics for value-based care. Value-based care is a system of rewarding doctors who receive better quality care scores from their patients. Then after that, we're going to talk with a company doing wearables for stress monitoring. You know, understanding stress and how it's affecting you is so valuable right now as we're all kind of in our homes going a little stir crazy. Let's talk about today. Today is episode 1, and we're going to hear from Axel Perez, who's our Vice President of RCM and Operations at DrChrono. We'll talk about Axel's story and what his role is at DrChrono before getting to some of the basics of the application. And then to wrap up, we're going to talk about this idea of an EHR platform and what it could be. Once you've listened to the show, let us know what was most meaningful to you by emailing us at podcast@drchrono.com. If there's any other topics you'd like us to cover, you know, email us that as well. Subscribe to the show to stay updated as we continue to release episodes. And with all that being said, let's get on with the show. Axel Perez is our VP of Operations at DrChrono. He's been at the company for 4 years and heads our revenue cycle management business. Axel, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. Glad to be here.
Awesome. So how did you get started working in and around healthcare?
Yeah, so right after I got out of school, just needed to earn some money, started doing prescription deliveries for a local pharmacy in New York. One day, the owner of the pharmacy stopped me, said that the person who was doing their insurance reimbursements quit, and they need somebody to jump in, wanted to train me how to do it. So literally middle of the afternoon, he just dropped me at a desk, taught me how to do some follow-up on claims, and I was off, and that was it. Been doing it for 22 years now.
So when you say claims, what exactly do you mean?
So, yeah. So at that time, you know, working at a pharmacy, there were certain medications that you could bill to Medicare that didn't go to a prescription plan. So we actually had to take the medical information from the prescription and handwrite it onto a piece of paper and send that into Medicare at that point. Mm-hmm. A couple of years later, we were keying it into a software. And it just kind of has, you know, developed since then.
So you had our revenue cycle management business. I was hoping you could sort of explain what that is to me, because honestly, I find it complicated and confusing.
Yeah. I get this question a lot. So revenue cycle management. So a lot of people equate revenue cycle management with medical billing. Mm-hmm. Medical billing, in fact, is a part of revenue cycle management. So the easiest way to describe it, the way that I describe it to people who know nothing about what I do, is it's the process of taking from when a patient first engages with a practice, whether they're scheduling or walking to their office or whatever that first engagement is, all the way till their claim for their services is at a $0 value. It's taking that and everything in between and reducing the number of clicks it takes to get from A to Z. So our job is to make sure that the practice is using the software efficiently, that the processes that the front desk uses, that the doctor uses when, you know, entering their medical notes and sending that over to their biller or to a billing company, that all those processes are refined. And then, of course, that the medical billing portion is, you know, done well and done cleanly so that we get paid fast, right? And mm-hmm. that's how we measure ourselves in revenue cycle, is how fast we get paid from the time a doctor sees the patient to the time that claim payment comes in.
Okay, so now that we know a little bit more about RCM and what that is, you know, I imagine you guys like charge a reasonable amount for it. Why don't doctors kind of do it themselves? Why do they usually invest in an RCM solution as opposed to trying to do it all themselves?
Well, I mean, you're aware that the U.S. healthcare system is not the simplest of things to understand.
I've heard this.
You know, we don't have a single payer system. You know, we have federal insurances, we have private insurances, we have comp insurances, we have accident insurance. And then you take all those groups and then you multiply it by 1,000, and that's how many insurances are out there, right? Mm-hmm. And each of them form their own rules. They have their own way that they want the claims to come to them. And then you layer on top of that, that there's, you know, hundreds of different billing systems. And, you know, it gets really complicated. So for a practice or for a hospital or for whoever, a health system, 60 to 70% of their expenses are tied up in the administrative cost of running that practice, right? Mm-hmm. And the largest portion of that is just figuring out how to get paid, mm-hmm. right? It's that revenue cycle that we talk about. And so because of that, it's much easier to hand that off to somebody who knows what they're doing, who's an expert at it, who doesn't have to try to figure out the rules, and let them get the money for you, right? So it really comes down to practice preference. Some practices love to do it themselves, but we have seen a trend over the last 10 years, right? The increasing number of practices continue to outsource. And I think the last stat I saw was 35% of practices now outsource their billing. And they expect that number to go well over 50% over the next 5 years.
Got it. So I feel like whenever I hear about this topic, it's like there's so many players involved, you know, between the practices, you know, you kind of imagine it should just be the practices and the patients. But then also you get like insurance. And there's a lot of people that do all these jobs. So, really simply, can you just tell me like the major players involved in like seeing a patient and getting a billing claim, submitted and completed?
Yeah. So it all starts on the very front end before the patient is even seen, right? It's understanding that, when they're scheduled, we need to make sure that we have the correct insurance information. The correct insurance information is loaded into the software, because a big piece of the reason doctors don't get paid is they just have incorrect information about the patient, about the patient's insurance. So it all starts even before they even see the doctor. And then at that point, so you have that front desk, or you have whoever's running the office or somebody like that who's involved at the very beginning, right? And then, of course, the doctor, we expect the doctor to not only, you know, perform his clinical duties, but he has to, or she has to, then turn around and also, you know, make sure that they understand the software well enough that they're using in order to put the data in correctly, so that when the claim flows from that office to the biller, that, you know, the claim is relatively ready to go. Okay. So you have that whole thing happening on the front end. On the back end, not only do you have your biller or billing team, but then you have a clearinghouse that's involved as well. And in U.S. healthcare, we have to bill through a clearinghouse, which is essentially a companies that create software that check claims before they go to insurance companies, right? And they just make sure that all the primary pieces are there. Doesn't mean it won't get denied, but they just check to make sure the primary pieces are there. So you have that clearinghouse, and then of course it goes to the payer. Hopefully the payer is going to process it in an automatic way. But if not, it kicks out and it goes to an adjuster, right? It goes to somebody to review it and wants to, you know, is going to look at that claim and look at any notes associated with that account to make sure that it should be covered. And then once that comes back, you know, it goes actually back through the exact same process, right? It goes back to the billing team and they finish whatever needs to happen on the back end.
Interesting. So I actually kind of thought insurance did the, like the claim accepting and the auditing of the claim, or the pay. I thought they were the payer as well as the auditor, but
the edits, which go through, which is what we call it in RCM, right? It's called claim edits. It's essentially the you know, programmed rules for allowing a claim to pass, right? They happen at many different levels. So level, you know, a claim edit level one is in your own software, your own billing software, right? So at DrChrono, we have, you know, a set of edits within our software that checks, you know, is the social security number in there, you know, 10 digits long and not 14 digits, right? Or things like that. Then you go to a level two edits, which is with the clearinghouse. Now they're going to have some of the payer, what we call payer level edits, which is what you're referring to. They'll have some of those built into their system. And you can, you know, if they catch anything, they'll send it back and we'll fix it and resend it again before it ever goes to the payer and it has to get denied. Now, once it goes through those two levels of edit, then it goes off to the payer. And the payer, they have what we call payer level edits. And those are sort of the ultimate, you know, like, is this claim going to actually pass and get paid, right? So you have lots of levels of edits there. And, you know, I think as we have progressed in RCM, you know, there's better ways to do this now, right? And something that we're actually going to be doing at DrChrono very soon is getting all those payer level edits and everything pushed all the way to the front end so that the claim, when it leaves the DrChrono system, will actually, you know, pass all those rules or be stopped and fixed before it ever leaves the DrChrono system.
Got it. Okay, so we've established that this is a complicated process. What is it about working in this space that keeps you around?
Man, I don't know. That's a great question. Maybe I shouldn't be around. No, I honestly actually love it. You know, any of my employees would tell you that I'm crazy because I kind of live and breathe medical billing and RCM. So for me, it's a couple of things, right? I mean, I love technology, and in RCM, there's always new technology that's coming out to make the processes better, right? And you know, now we're getting into things like machine learning and AI and robotic process automation, and those things are exciting and fun for me. So I love that part of it. I'm also a guy who just likes to learn and adapt quickly to situations. So, you know, the U.S. healthcare system, man, there's always something to learn, right? So, you know, understanding, you know, how something works today, a year from now, we know it's not going to be exactly the same. And it's understanding, you know, you can really set yourself apart as a company, as an individual contributor, by being somebody who adapts and learns those things very quickly and, you know, can make it seamless for a doctor of practice, you know, when it comes to their processes. So, you know, for me, it's been pretty much my whole professional life. And, you know, I still love it to this day.
Yeah, so funny that it's almost like an irony or fate that brought you to it. But it sounds like you kind of ended up in the right spot.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've talked for about 10 minutes without mentioning coronavirus, which is like unheard of on a podcast here.
this time of year. So I just want to ask about that. Like, what have you seen, and how are like our clients at DrChrono being affected by coronavirus?
Well, you know, I think we're seeing a wide range of impacts. You know, we have practices that have really, really been hit hard, right? What I would call some of the physical type practices, you know, chiropractors, physical therapy, elective type practices like plastic surgery, they've been hit really hard, right? Even to the point where we've seen some of our clients who have actually, you know, had to go out of business. I would say the greater percentage of our clients just saw a reduction in their volume, right? Just, you know, not getting the appointment volume that they are used to, not getting the appointment volume that they need. Mm-hmm. And as a result, you know, just missing out on a lot of revenue over the last few months. Not different than, you know, many other businesses in our country at this point, right? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, beyond that, you know, I think we have some practices that have thrived, right? Telehealth practices that were, you know, ready to go for telehealth even before, you know, COVID hit, you know, they've thrived in this, right? And they were ready for it. And, you know, another great example of how, you know, being proactive on technology, you know, really helps. So, you know, we've seen that wide range. I think, you know, we're seeing volumes come back. You know, as the country continues to reopen, obviously it's a little tenuous at this point. Yeah. And, you know, we don't know what's going to happen. Different states have different impacts and different volumes of the pandemic. So we'll see what happens. But, you know, at this point, we are starting to see volumes come back. We're very happy to see our practices reopening and taking patients again. And, you know, we're doing all we can to kind of get them there, right? Especially on the telehealth side.
Yeah, definitely. So let's get a little more specific. We talked in general about how, you know, all sorts of practices are getting hit by COVID-19, but, you know, how have you seen like RCM be affected specifically?
Yeah, I mean, look, when volume, I think there's two sides to this, right? There's sort of the financial impact, right? Which is volumes go down. Mm-hmm. That means less work for us, less money for us, right? And so, you know, we had to sort of reprioritize what we were doing, right? You know, in a sense, it gave us an opportunity to go back and really start looking back at older claims and digging up AR that needed to be worked and trying to get those extra dollars in for our practices. So that's you know, one part of it. But I would also say that there's been a lot of changes in RCM because we went from telehealth sort of being, sort of a side thought for many practices to being the main thought, right? And the main type of visit. And, you know, as that has happened, insurances have responded, Medicare and Medicaid have responded by covering these things. But, you know, I think it's still a work in progress, right? The rules continue to change. Mm-hmm.
Right. I mean, yeah, it's always, like you said before, it's always a learning experience. It's going to, the tools are going to be different year to year. So it's always kind of constantly shifting, and it's definitely an exciting time to be involved in telehealth and healthcare just in general.
Yeah.
Next, I want to talk about the DrChrono product a little bit more. Sure. I get asked all the time, you know, where I work, what I do. And once I've explained that DrChrono is not a real doctor, I'm left to try and explain like what an EHR is. And I find that to be really challenging. So my question to you is like, how do you answer that?
Wow. Great. Who really knows? Who really knows what an EHR is? No. So it's a good question, right? I mean, yeah. Every practice in the country practically now uses an EHR, though the typical person really doesn't know what it is. Mm-hmm. So if I'm talking to somebody who doesn't know an EHR at all, what I tell them is, hey, you know, when you go to the doctor and you're telling the doctor what's wrong with you and they're sitting at a computer, like typing in everything you're saying, they're working in the type of software that DrChrono creates. Right. Mm-hmm. So essentially, an EHR was created to collect and protect medical data for a patient, right? Mm-hmm. And it allows that practice, that doctor to, you know, keep track of everything that's happening without having a paper file where you have to remember, you know, to go back in and update, you know, did I give medications? Did I, you know, what did I talk to this person about last time we spoke? You know, it's all right there. Any doctor could step in, read that and understand it. Mm-hmm. So that's the beauty of an EHR, right? It tracks everything, it records, it protects the patient data. And then it also allows for all that data that's been collected to be pushed to the back end of the system, which is your billing, your practice management system, your billing system. And again, it creates efficiencies on the back end. Right now, we're not having to key in a bunch of information to bill a claim. It's all collected right there. And I think probably the third aspect of an EHR is just the greater good sort of aspect of it, which is it has allowed, you know, us as a country and really everywhere in the world to collect data and use that data to do predictive type analytics, right? And understand, you know, what is happening in healthcare, you know, where are we seeing, you know, what type of sicknesses are we seeing in certain parts of the country, or you know what is the rate of people taking this certain medication or things like that. We now have the ability to take those that type of data, and each EHR has that data, and being able to sort of now do this predictive and sort of tabulated data collection, so that, you know, hopefully it's going to be for the greater good of everybody.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. So, you know, that's a great way to answer, like, what is an EHR simply? Now I'm going to ask you sort of the inverse of that question, is what makes an EHR more complicated than just, you know, paper records on the internet?
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, I think EHRs have evolved. If you look at some of the older EHR systems that are out there, they're extremely complicated, right? They weren't designed with the workflow of a practice in mind necessarily, or the workflow has changed for a practice, you know, since they were designed. So, you know, what the things that you do not want in your EHR, right? The things that you have to be careful of are, you know, EHRs that, number one, don't have enough security in place to protect the patient data. That's mm-hmm. that's the number one problem always. Mm-hmm. Number two, you want something that follows your flow of work, right? It can be customized to your flow of work, at least to a point. And that's important because, you know, doctors are creatures of habit. They don't want to change their entire practice to suit a piece of software, mm-hmm. right? And so the software should gently push them towards a more efficient process, but not completely change their world, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so that's really important. And then you want a software that's going to be nimble enough to change as time goes on, right? This is why cloud-based software like DrChrono is really popular right now. You know, we have the ability to create a change and push it out to all of our users overnight if we need to. A perfect example of that is, you know, our telehealth feature that got launched just recently. Mm-hmm. It is something that we knew had to get done quickly. And, you know, we were able to put that together really in record time and get it out to our users.
Yeah, I really can't wait to talk about telehealth. But before we do, I kind of want to talk just really finish the topic of the core features of DrChrono before we talk about this new thing. So let's dive into mobile. How does mobile change the way that providers can care for patients?
Yeah, so look, I mean, our entire world is mobile now, right? Mm-hmm. Doctors, you know, it makes the office experience better, for one, right? Mm-hmm. If I'm a physician, you know, and I'm interacting with a patient, I don't want to have to stare at a screen that's pushed up against the far right wall in mm-hmm. order to talk to a patient who's sitting on a bed, you know, 4 feet away. Mm-hmm. Instead, I can have my iPad, I can have my phone, whatever I want to record my data on, and I can stand in front of the patient and speak to them, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's a big piece, and it's, you know, that bedside manner that people want. I think that adds to it, right? But mm-hmm. even beyond that, you know, doctors work a lot of hours, as we know. Mm-hmm. And, even after hours, there's demands on them for, you know, refills of prescriptions, and, you know, a patient shows up at the EAR and they need to update something, or somebody wants to ask them about their notes. They have the ability now to pull out their phone and refill a prescription, send it over to the pharmacy, or take a look at that patient's chart. And that's important, right? I mean, it's a quality of life issue for physicians, honestly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I speak to our clients and I speak to other physicians, that's a big thing for them, right? Is not being tied to a desktop computer at their desk in an office, trying to hammer out, you know, medical notes all night. I think that's how, you know, that's how mobile really has impacted the industry. And I think DrChrono has led the way on sort of mobile integration with physicians' offices.
Yeah, I mean, I think we as listeners can all sort of relate to that. You know, having a work phone is kind of a game changer for just getting work done. It's kind of an extension of your desktop. So, you know, I guess it's about time. I think technology and healthcare kind of lags behind, you know, the rest of the business world. So mobile is a game changer, and it's been around for a couple of years, but it still feels like it's just arriving.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So again, I'm going to ask about, like, we talked about what's great about mobile, but what are some of the challenges of integrating a mobile app with a native web service like DrChrono?
Well, again, I mean, you know, priority number one in healthcare is always security, right? Mm-hmm. So we have to make sure all channels are very secure, patient data is protected. So that's number one. Number two is connectivity, right? Doctors have to be able to get to that data. So we can't have technical issues with our mobile program, just like we can't have issues with our, you know, our native desktop program. Mm-hmm. So, you know, those are some of the challenges. I think in addition to that, you know, the mobile healthcare features, let's call them, are still always evolving right now, right? And physicians will always find the next thing that they need, right? They absolutely need this as part of their mobile app. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for a company like DrChrono, it's really understanding and listening to the doctors on those type of things, and then prioritizing, you know, what can we get in there? What will make sense in a mobile application, not only, you know, aesthetically, but also functionally, right? I mean, we have to make sure that whatever they're doing there can reflect within our main product and offer the same sort of quality presentation that they're used to from DrChrono.
Yeah, definitely can't do everything all at once. Right. So kind of a curveball question here. You know, we advertise the power of mobile in the doctor's office. Have you yourself ever received treatment with a mobile device in a doctor's office?
Yeah, absolutely. I actually have seen a doctor that is on the DrChrono system, and they use the iPad right in front of me. And unfortunately, I had to stop seeing that doctor because every time I was there, they would just ask me for training. But no, you know, they actually really loved the product. They would just tell me, they would always have these sort of anecdotal stories about, you know, being at a restaurant and being able to refill a prescription or, you know, doing different things. But yeah, I mean, for me personally, I love the idea of, I'm a conversational type of person. Mm-hmm. I don't want it to feel clinical when I'm at the doctor. I don't like going to the doctor. And so, you know, for me, having the doctor be able to just sit in front of me and, you know, just look me in the eyes and talk to me about, you know, whatever the situation is that day, to me, that makes a world of difference, right? So mm-hmm. I think that's, you know, my own personal experience. That's how I you know, I can appreciate it.
Yeah. I love that. We touched a little bit on billing and RCM in the beginning. I just want to ask, you know, again, like, why is this part so confusing? Why does it seem like there's so many ways for doctors to not get paid and only like one way to actually get paid? Why is it so difficult?
Well, I mean, listen, if we really look more deeply at it. Mm-hmm. Insurances are not incented to pay claims, mm-hmm. right? Matter of fact, most insurances are incented not to pay claims.
Right. They're a business.
And they would never admit that, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, your claim has to meet every single rule that that insurance set up. Mm-hmm. And, you know, unfortunately, insurances to some degree are allowed to create their own, you know, own sort of rules and parameters for the data that comes to them to get paid, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, it really is just a headache for somebody who's not focused on it full time. You know, that being said, this is why we're moving more to like a value-based payment model or a quality care model, mm-hmm. right? We want to be proactive about healthcare. Mm-hmm. We want to reward doctors for, you know, doing a good job at, you know, treating their patients in between visits with, you know, mm-hmm. care plans and, you know, tracking diets and all kinds of things and remote patient monitoring. And I could get into a whole list of those things that are evolving now in healthcare to help a practice, you know, get paid additionally in different ways that also benefits the patient and it creates a healthier patient. And why are we doing that? I mean, the outcome is supposed to be that we just have healthier people, mm-hmm. right? So that's the goal, right? I mean, and I think, you know, that complicated sort of billing, I think that'll change. It'll be a different sort of complication, but it should be something that's a little more straightforward.
Yeah, definitely. So you mentioned like the shift towards value-based care and everything we're doing as far as a country, you know, federally to sort of make that happen. There's a lot of rules and regulations being put into place to sort of push care towards outcomes and value-based care. Question for you would be, you know, do you think this is enough? We're kind of in the early stages of seeing this shift. So have you seen any changes yourself? Do you think it'll be enough and sort of project out like what's going to happen in the next 10 years with insurance and billing?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. You know, there's a lot of data being collected around value-based care right now, mm-hmm. Around remote patient monitoring. And we'll see. I mean, I think it's too early to definitively say that, you know, the incentives that doctors get from doing this is enough to have made, you know, the nation healthier, right? I don't know that we have that information today. Mm-hmm. Certainly more needs to be done. You know, I think there's more forward-thinking insurance companies out there who are trying to do more. Kaiser Permanente, for example, they're a very forward-thinking, mm-hmm. You know, insurance company, right? And are really leaning heavily towards value-based care. And mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's going to be companies like that who sort of lead the way here, right? Mm-hmm. And the government will fall in line as needed. And you know, we'll see what happens. I mean, I think the data collection that happens over the next few years is going to be really interesting to understand exactly where we stand with value-based care and its impact on people themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, frankly, it's just a really exciting time to be in this space. I mean, not like without even before COVID. But, you know, we've kind of alluded to how COVID has affected things and, you know, the coming out of like telehealth. So what have you seen in regards to telehealth so far in the first sort of 4 months of lockdown? And do you see telehealth as being here to stay during and after COVID?
Yeah, look, I mean, I think if there's any good that could come from a pandemic, it's the fact that doctors and health tech systems and insurance companies were forced to acknowledge telehealth as a real thing, right? Mm-hmm. We're going to come out of COVID knowing that just about every practice is going to have some form of telehealth connectivity for their practice, right? Mm-hmm. And understanding that most insurances are going to cover this moving forward, up to and including our federal insurances like Medicare and Medicaid. Now, will they be here to stay? Will they reimburse at the same level as an office visit always, as they do right now? That's yet to be determined, right? But, you know, I can tell you, as the father of a teenage daughter, getting her to get on the phone with a doctor and talk to them is way easier than scheduling her to try to get to an office, right? Yeah. There's definitely benefits of telehealth that are here to stay. And, and you know, I think we will have, and this is just my personal opinion, I think that we will have a much more willing patient demographic to that will engage with their practice, their local practice, their family doctor, their pediatricians, way more fully than they would have if they're just kind of going in every 6 months for that checkup or whenever they feel bad, right? So, you know, I think those are the benefits that come from it.
Yeah, and I don't think it'll totally replace face-to-face medical care, but what it does do is it opens up like a new avenue or line of communication between the doctors and patients, and that can like really only be a good thing. I mean,
in my well, opinion. And it shouldn't. We don't want it to replace face-to-face. I don't think. At least I don't. Right. Yeah, I appreciate being able to sit in front of my doctor and talk to him, but you know, we do need. We do need medical care to be more accessible in this country. And this makes it extremely accessible because the one thing we do know is that people have phones and we know that people want to be on their phones, right? So, hey, maybe they think they're on TikTok and not on telehealth, right? So, you know, it's great. It's great. They you know, get people engaged again.
Yeah, if we've done that, I think we'll be the next like unicorn slash Pegasus slash I don't even know. So okay, we talked a little bit about our phones, and you know, the last thing I want to talk about here is platforms. And platforms are one of those terms that, you know, people throw around in all sorts of industries all the time. Like famous people have them, tech companies have them, celebrities on TikTok have them, Olympic high divers, they all have a platform. But what does it mean for us at DrChrono to build a platform?
Yeah, I mean, so I think the most successful practices, the most successful health systems, they do everything in a singular environment. Right. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? You know, it means that I have my my EHR and my practice management and my billing system, and I have the mobile advantages, and I have a check-in available, and I have mobile payments available. I have all these things sort of integrated into one environment for my practice. And it, you know, it really reduces the stress of a doctor of trying to figure out what's going on around him, right? All the administrative stuff that's going around. So not only does it cut costs for them doing it this way, but you know, it also just simplifies the delivery of healthcare. So for DrChrono, that's what we want to do, right? When you log into your DrChrono software, we want you to be able to do everything that you need to do to service your patient in a really high level way, you know, right there. We don't want you to have to think about having to go to other softwares or doing things outside of DrChrono, because now you become more inefficient, right? There's more room for error, and that's never good for anybody. So, you know, for us, building a platform is really giving the doctor every tool they need to succeed.
I love that. So we I mentioned earlier, you know, a lot of people want to build a platform. What separates us at DrChrono from every other company that's trying to build a platform? Including, well, you know, the Facebooks and the Twitters of the world. Sorry, I feel like I should clarify that.
So look, I think, you know, we're trying to be a very forward thinking company, right? We're trying to be we're trying to think ahead of, you know, where we are today in healthcare and trying to understand where we should be. And I think that's an important difference, right? I think most EHRs, most PM systems, most software that you encounter in the world is a response to what we need right now, right? And that's good. You need that. But in addition to that, we should be thinking about what do we need a year from now, 5 years from now? And are we laying the groundwork to get there? And I think that's one of the things we've done well at DrChrono, right? It's not a surprise that we were on iPad very early, right? Mm-hmm. When the iPad came out, our app was on it. And, you know, that, and we continue that trend, I think, as a credit to our founders, Michael and Daniel. You know, they've always been sort of forward thinking about healthcare and how we're going to continue to lead. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to me, that's what the big difference is. That's what draws me to DrChrono. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so one more question on platforms, and this one is a bit ambiguous because, you know, I'm not sure that you're ever done. But how close are we to being done with a platform?
Done? I don't know that anybody's ever done with a platform. So I hate to say that there's any sort of measurement that could say you're at any part of a platform. We have a great active platform for our practices, right? It's usable. They are gaining efficiency from it. They're getting paid. But every person who uses DrChrono, every person who uses any EHR, they could probably give you a list of 47 different things that they want added, right? Or changed or moved or whatever.
or more, yeah.
Right. And, you know, the interesting thing about doing operations at DrChrono and being part of the RCM team is that we are actually DrChrono's largest client. We have more people working in DrChrono's system than any client that we have, any outside client. Mm-hmm. And what that means is that we have our own wish list of things that we want DrChrono to do in DrChrono, right? And so are we ever going to be done? No. And we shouldn't expect to ever be done. We should always be expecting to get better. But you know, I guess done in our world means, you know, can a doctor use it efficiently? Can they see patients effectively? And can they get paid quickly, right? Mm-hmm. And I would say that we check all those boxes.
Awesome. Yeah, I mean, in the software age, I don't think anything's ever done. So great answer. Okay, I got one more question here before you get out of here. Sure. So you spent 4 years almost at the company. How has DrChrono grown during your time here?
Yeah, we've grown a lot. I mean, I think, you know, we continue to mature as a company just in terms of understanding healthcare. I think that's number one. You know, we continue to listen to our clients and try to be better every day because of that. I think we brought in people who understand the industry, are helping to make the product better, are helping to make our services better. And, you know, we want to continue to do that. I think that's important for DrChrono is just to never settle on being good enough, but just to continue moving forward. And I think over my 4 years here, you know, the one thing I can truly appreciate is that I feel like we're always continually trying to, you know, push our limits and be better.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. All right, Axel, we're going to end it there. Thanks for joining me. If the listener has any questions for Axel about, you know, advice on RCM, just kidding. Or if you have any questions for the show, please email us at info@drchrono.com. Axel, thanks for doing this.
Of course. Anytime. Had a great time. Thanks so much. Cool.
All right. I'll talk to you later.